Yeah, we are live.
Okay, good evening, everybody. Welcome again to this series of webinars, basically aimed at orthopedic postgraduate students and DNB students, brought to you by the Orthopedic Research and Education Foundation through OrthoDV. I think today we have the pleasure of having Professor Anil Bhatt from Manipal, from Kasturba Gandhi Medical College and Hospitals, Manipal, who's going to talk to us about the claw hand. So assessment, examination, and management of the claw hand. I think this is quite an important part of your exam, and this is, a claw hand is a case you could very well have. There could be various causes for it. It could be post-traumatic from ischemia, nerve injuries, could be secondary to Hansen's, and you have to be able to assess these patients carefully and then plan your management. So I think we are really lucky to have Anil with us today, and I'll hand it over to him for the next half an hour or so, and then we will have time to ask any questions. Over to you, Anil. Thanks.
Thank you, sir. It's a pleasure to be again seeing John sir here after a long time. And thanks to Orthopedic Research and Education Foundation for this opportunity. And it's always a pleasure to teach whatever forum it is. And one of the topics, it's always, I'll just share the screen. Which is always kind of, you know, confusing in terms of management. Every time a postgraduate asks me, how can we remember so much of tendon transfers and things like that? So this is a brief lecture on, you know, assessment, how to basically present the case in the exam. So if there's a claw hand anywhere in 50 kilometers radius around the exam hall, make sure that it will be kept for a short case. So to evaluate and plan your management, predominantly in ulnar claw hand, but sometimes there could be a total claw hand also. The examiner basically wants you to tell which nerve is involved, whether it's ulnar or ulnar and median nerve sometimes. At what level, that's very important. Is it a high level injury or a low level injury? And also the etiology, what is it based on your history and everything, and if there's any complications which you have to pick up. Now, I just went through the previous question papers, and these are the things I saw. Enumerate the causes. That is one thing. Management is the other one. Especially Hansen's, leprosy in our country is still, you know, quite common. And so if at all there's a Hansen's disease, and then it's like having tuberculosis as a long case. Hansen's claw hand, again, there'll be a lot of questions. So you need to be thorough with that. Definition of ulnar claw hand, discuss the tendon transfers. So this is one question, might be a little difficult in terms of tendon transfers, but I will try to make it as simple as possible. So these are the common questions asked. There were some couple of other short notes like Zancoli's capsulorraphy and other things. But these were the questions I saw in the previous, especially the DNB papers. So coming to the definition itself, all of you know, it's basically hyperextension at the MCP joints and flexion at the IP joints. That's a characteristic resting posture. So this hyperextension here and flexion of the IP joints, it's also called intrinsic minus, means the intrinsics are absent or paralyzed here. So that there is an imbalance of weak intrinsics, basically the introsei and the lumbricals, versus the normal extrinsics, the long extensors and flexor muscles. So it's also called as the intrinsic minus hand. Now, causes wise, trauma, you know, is one of the major causes. And Hansen's, as is already mentioned, compressive neuropathies, it could be at the cuboidal tunnel or it could be the Guyon's canal. So one of the places there could be a common compression neuropathies seen. But we should not always forget the central causes. It could be right from the, you know, root of the neck, the brachial plexus, the T1 nerve root compression. It could also be at the spinal cord level, like polio, syringomyelia, or a motor neuron disease, or a Charcot-Marie-Tooth disease. So these could be rare presentation, but always remember that, always remember the central causes also. It's not always that you just look at a claw and then say it's ulnar, which it need not be. It could be a root level injury. So the evaluation of presentation of a claw hand during a case, we expect to you to talk about the deformity, the disability. What is the status of the extensor apparatus? What is the status of the joints itself? Because these are all helpful for the management, for your decision making and management. And of course, if there are any complications. And complications commonly are seen in Hansen's disease most of the time. So if you start the inspection, basically when you take the history, a brief history in a short case, and then we generally ask, start from the, you know, we start the reverse. We always ask, what is your diagnosis? And then what are the physical findings to substantiate your diagnosis? So you would have taken the history and you know what is the background of the patient. So you would start telling that on inspection, you see a deformity. This classical claw hand deformity is that the sign is called the Duchenne sign, actually. It's expression of a functional defect in the opening mechanism of the hand, which means that you will see the claw not when a patient is holding a hand like this. You would see only when you ask the patient to open up the hand. Then only you will see the claw. So always make sure you ask the patient to open up the hand fully like this. And then only you make sure that, so when the patient is flexing, making a fist, you won't see that. But when they extend the hand, the fingers, the IP joint, then only you will see this claw. So the deformity is basically, as I said, expression of a functional defect in the opening mechanism. Now, you also need to look at different types of claw. You know, every claw is not different. Now, if you look at this claw and this claw now, right, this is more you know, pronounced compared to this. This looks slightly milder claw compared to this claw, which is much more predominant, right? But then you need to look why it is so, and you should be very careful. So you see a scar here in this patient here, and then you know it's a probably a low ulnar nerve injury. And then this patient, there's absolutely nothing, which means that you have to go up. You have to go up and trace, and maybe you'll find a cause there in the elbow here. It could be, again, as I said, till the root of the neck, but at least this. So this, where a higher level injury gives you a minimal claw compared to a lower level injury, which gives you a predominantly, you know, very badly looking claw here. This is the paradox you see here. And the reason is that here, if there is a lesion here, the flexor, the FTP of the little and ring finger is also paralyzed here. And so this flexion will be reduced and the claw will be much more minimal compared to a lower level injury. Here, the FDPs are still working, and that's why you have the claw so prominent. So this is the ulnar paradox, which a lot of examiners would ask you. But again, there's another lesson here. The moral of the story here is, again, expose the patient adequately and look for proximal causes. We've had enough cases, students, where they have missed these kind of injuries, which is higher up, because they have not exposed the patient. Here you see still this, the shirt is seen. Ideally, you need to remove the shirt here and make sure you look at the neck and come down here. So don't miss the proximal lesion. Same thing happens when there's a foot drop case. You should make sure you go all the way till the hip and the spine and examine the patient. Very, very important. Associate deformities, you need to check like this. It's a completely flat hand there. No wasting of both thenar and hypothenar muscles here. So which is probably a total claw hand. This first dorsal interosseous web space, this web space wasting is again a very predominant thing. All the web spaces, all the intermetacarpal spaces are wasted here, but much more here because the first dorsal interossea is a quite bulky muscle, plus you have the adductor pollicis. Both are supplied by the ulnar nerve, and so that wasting is quite predominant here. Hansen's patients, you would see these kind of changes here because the sensation is numb, I mean, you know, reduced there. So they have this trauma which happens to the fingertips. When they're working, the interosseous balance is lost. The normal metacarpal arch, what you see here, is missing here. So that kind of gets flattened out here. And a lot of these patients, because they can't have a good grip, they start flexing the wrist to get this kind of a grip. It's more of a tenodesis kind of an effect. So they start developing, they slowly develop this flexion deformity here like this. So the wrist, habitually flexing the wrist to trying to pick up objects. So that becomes a problem when you think of management of these patients. After inspection is the palpation. During palpation, the nerve palpation is the most important thing. You would look for the tenderness of the nerve, thickening of the nerve. Here, especially cubital tunnel, you look for subluxation of the nerve. As you flex and extend the elbow, the nerve could be subluxating. So that itself could be irritating the nerve and causing problems. In a Hansen's neuritis, the nerve will be thickened and tender, and sometimes quite thick like this. You see here, it could be an abscess actually inside the nerve. Any skin scars and then in the local tunnel sign is very, very important during a palpation. When you move these patients, what you see actually when you ask them to move, what you see is the disability of the patient. Why this claw is so disabling? So disabling is, the disability is basically a functional defect in the closing pattern. I told you deformity is seen as a expression of functional defect in the opening pattern. Now, when you ask the patient to flex and make a fist, then the whole thing is reversed, actually. Normally, if you see in a normal hand, we flex the MCP joint first and then the IP joints. But in a claw hand, the IP joints flex first and then the MCP, because the MCP flexor is lost. So what happens, the hand folds upon itself. So if they want to grasp an object, they can't do that because the fingers, the IP joints close. So this is the disability the patient has. I'll just show you how it is. So this is a normal hand here. You can easily grasp because MCPs are flexing and then the IP joints come in. Now for this here, it's not. So the IP joints are flexing first, the MCPs are not. So it's difficult for them to even grasp, you know, bigger objects also. The power grip, precision handling is lost. Small objects like this, like a coin, manipulating the coins is very difficult for me. This is a normal hand. You can easily do that. But for here, the intraosseous not working. So the patient doesn't have abduction, adduction. And again, the MCP flexion is not working. So it's difficult for them to do all these things. So the loss of independent MCP flexor is a major disability for this. That's why they come to you. Because of the claw, they might not come. But for the disability, they will come. In Indian patients, a lot of patients complain that they can't mix the rice. When they want to eat food, they can't really mix the rice. It's very difficult for them. That's one of the major disabilities our patients always complain. So other disabilities could be loss of protective sensation and functional sensibility. The loss of abduction and adduction, as I said, the finger span reduces. This is your finger span. You can abduct fully, adduct fully. So that is lost here. Loss of cupping. So this cupping of the hand, you know, is again lost for these patients because you don't have these movements here on the hypothenar side. That again is a quite disabling thing. So all these leads to what's called the shrinkage in the working space of the hand. The working space is when you open up the hand completely like this and make a fist completely. So this is our working space of the hand. Now I can't do this. I do only this, and this also is limited. My working space of the hand reduces. So that's what is a disability for the patient. Measurements, there are a couple of angles actually what we measure here. But before that, you need to know what is this problem here in terms of extensor apparatus. And the phenomenon is called as the Bouvier-Beer phenomenon, which is basically checking the integrity of the central and the lateral slips of the extensors. So here you have the hyperextension here. So the long extensors here, when they come, they can't extend this IP joint here because all their energy is spent here. So this part here, because of hyperextension, the long extensors can't work. Now, if you just assist this slightly, if you flex this like this, then the long flexors will act as long as they're intact. They're not damaged. And that damage a lot of times happens in Hansen's disease. I'll come to that later. So if the extensor apparatus is intact, if you just give that flexion back to the MCP joint by assisting it, then they're able to extend the IP joint. So this is called the Bouvier-Beer phenomenon. And I'll just demonstrate that in a patient. So this is the claw hand patient has. The moment I give some assistance for MCP flexion, he's able to extend this finger, the IP joints especially, which means his extensor apparatus is intact and not damaged. The extension of that is what we do during the examination is calculating this assisted angle. It's a very important angle you calculate for your management. I'll come to that again later. So it's how much of assistance is required at the MCP joint, which will give this extension at the IP joint. That's what we are calculating. So that is the assisted angle. So if I assist this MCP to about 20, 30 degrees and patient is able to do it, that means that extensor apparatus is very good and you don't need a major tendon transfer in this patient, but just a static procedure is good enough for the patient to start doing his activities. If I have to assist more than that, more than 30 degrees, you know, then which means the entire apparatus is weak, which means you might want to have more power there. You might have to have a dynamic tendon transfers to come in. So that is the importance of an assisted angle. The second angle you calculate is a contracture angle. This is for like any tendon transfer, we make sure that the joints are supple. So especially IP joints over time, because they are flexed, they might go into flexion deformity here. Okay. So passively you check that whether you are able to passively get full extension to neutral or not, and then calculate the angle. And so that is the amount of FFD this PIP joint has. So that is your contracture angle. other angle you calculate in a total claw hand would be a thumb web contracture, because the adductor pollicis is paralyzed. And so slowly what happens is there is a contracture there, and how much of web space opening is there, you need to see, so that again, when you do a surgery like an opponent's plasty, the thumb web contracture should not be there. You need to get rid of that. The neurological examination special tests for you to differentiate is it high level injury or low level injury. The first muscle you're supposed to check is the FCU. If the FCU is working, which means it is a low level injury, and the FCU is not working, it means a high palsy. The ring and little finger FDP also needs to be checked along with that. Plus, of course, you come down to hand muscle. So you start with FCU testing by flexion of the wrist and ulnar deviation, and then you check for the muscle there. You also check for the FDP of the ring and the little finger. So if these two are working, means it's a low level injury. It's not a high level injury. And then you come down and do a couple of tests. This test, the Pitras test tube test, is basically to check. So you have the middle finger kept on a tabletop, and that is a normal hand which is showing here. And then you ask them to abduct and adduct, and that's lost because the second and third dorsal intraoccipitae are paralyzed. So it's a simple test for you to check how the intraoccipitae are paralyzed. Okay. So the other test, what we do is this crossing one finger over the other, especially the index over the middle finger. That is checking the first palmar and second dorsal intraoccipitae. One is adduction, one is abduction. So you're checking that. So on the affected hand, patient is not able to do that. That also checks the coordination between this, how bad the ulnar nerve injury is. So these are two tests which you do. The other one, all of you are familiar, is the classic Frohman sign, or the test is called as a book test. The sign is called as a Frohman sign. So using your first dorsal intraoccipitae and the adductor pollicis, keep it parallel like this. And then if that is paralyzed, then if the median nerve is intact, then the FPL will work here, and that will hold the book here. If median nerve and ulnar nerve both are paralyzed, the book just comes out. So that is the Frohman sign you would see. The other thing you see is a Wattenberg sign. What happens is the extensor digitorum minimus, which is there, which will abduct the little finger here, and that is unopposed by the third palmar intraoccipitae paralysis. So what happens is that finger stays away like this. The little finger stays away like this, and this is called as the Wattenberg sign. Now, the next one is the CART test. CART test, if you see clinical DAS, probably one of the only figure which is probably wrong in that sense. That's a beautiful book. I read it even now, but this is not correct. The CART test, where you hold the card with your hand fully like this and then try to pull out, is not correct. That's because you have this. If you use all your force, then obviously even in a normal hand, this comes out, right? So the correct way of doing is this, like this. Okay, you need to use corresponding fingers like this. Okay, and you need to keep shifting, and you need to also use corresponding dominant hand also. Actually, you should ask the patient and then check that. So this is the correct way of doing a CART test, and that because both of you have to give equal power. If you use your entire hand, then obviously even with normal people, it will come down. Sensations vary according to the cause. So you have in peripheral nerve lesions, you know at what level and what nerve is involved. In polio, if it's a case of a polio, it's normal. In leprosy, it's absent or a glove-like because of neuropathies. And in syringomyelia, there could be a partial loss of sensations. Now, evaluation for what else you require for management, you need to check the adaptive shortening of long finger flexors because they have this wrist flexion habit. So you need to check that. Strength of the digital extensors and flexors, because you want to know what tendon transfers you have to do. What is a sensory deficit? What is the joint status? Very important. Is there a nerve tenderness? Is an active neuritis going on in this patient? And grip and pinch strength and functional status and donor muscle strength. When you are presenting a case of claw and if you tell, sir, the FDS power is grade 5, I know that you've already thought about a tendon transfer. You know the management. So donor muscle strength, whether you're presenting a case of a foot drop, and you tell tibialis posterior is grade 5, which makes the examiner happy actually because you've already thought about the management. So that's very important to check the donor muscle strength. Some complicating features like this, as I told you earlier, this happens in leprosy patients. The extensor apparatus here gets damaged slowly because they don't know how much pressure they're using. So when they're washing clothes or doing household chores, they can damage this extensor apparatus. And as I said, nerve abscess. Sometimes we see this nerve abscess in this patient in acute neuritis status. That's very important. Auto amputation at the fingertips. These are all complications probably you will have to look at. Not very commonly seen in our scenarios because most of them are trauma cases. So at the end of the case, you have to tell what is your clinical diagnosis. Or when we ask for a short case, we start with what's your diagnosis. Don't tell claw hand. Claw hand is not a diagnosis. Claw hand is just a deformity. So you need to tell high or a low ulnar nerve palsy. If there's a median nerve, you need to tell ulnar nerve and median nerve palsy. And then you need to tell with claw deformity. Okay, so it's just a deformity with what is the etiology? Is it traumatic? Is it Hansen's? That you need to tell. And as I showed you, if there's any complications. So this is how you need to tell your diagnosis. Don't tell foot drop as a diagnosis. Foot drop is not a diagnosis. A common peroneal nerve palsy is a diagnosis. Okay. So that is very important when you tell the diagnosis. Just don't say claw hand. Don't say right-sided claw hand. Right-sided high or low ulnar nerve palsy with claw hand is the correct diagnosis. The next question we ask is, what will you do? Don't jump and say, I'll do a tendon transfer. For any case, for that matter, for long case, short case, whatever. When we ask you the question, what will you do? You will say, I would like to confirm my diagnosis. I'll investigate the patient first. This should be your answer always. A lot of times people jump and say, for a hip case, I'll do total joint replacement. I would confirm my diagnosis, investigate the patient, and then I'll decide on the management. So same way here, you might have to take an X-ray sometimes in some patients. You might have to do it like a cubital tunnel. You might have to take an elbow X-ray. There could be a problem there with the condylar fractures sometimes, a nerve conduction studies. An ultrasound and an MRI sometimes can be taken for like a Guillain scan or a cubital. We do quite frequently ultrasound examination. If there's a tumor sitting, there is schwannoma of the ulna, we might have to do an MRI. And skin biopsy if it's a Hansen's case, that's very important. Now, coming to the principles of management. Okay, the most important thing is first we would want to splint this. Okay, and the splint used is a knuckle bender splint. A knuckle bender means you bend the knuckle here, means you're giving a MCP flexion. The moment you do that, as I told you earlier, a lot of things, disability comes down. Because the MCP is flexing, now the IP, the extensors are acting on the IP, patient is able to do activities much better. It also will, you know, reduce the deformity for the patient. So a knuckle bender splint like this, and if there are contracture angles, which I showed you, IP joint contractures, this is one of the best methods to get rid of that before we think of tendon transfers. These are finger casts, cylindrical POP casts. Directly we put the plaster POP, no padding here. And then we correct it. Every 2 days, we change it. Even with a stubborn deformity, it gets corrected within a week if you do two or three sittings of this. So a very effective way, which I learned when I was doing my 15-day fellowship in Agra and Jalma Institute. That's a purely leprosy center. Dr. Malaviya was in charge there at that time. Beautiful place. I learned all my tenant transfers in that place. Very nice place to go and visit sometime if you're interested in tenant transfers. Now, traumatic claw hand, if you have the most, obviously the most important, the common treatment would be a nerve repair if the patient comes early, or if the patient comes late, it would be a grafting. So if you, there's an ulnar nerve injury here. So based on the gap here, if it is can be directly sutured end to end without tension, that is the best thing. If not, if it's there's a gap there and there's a lot of tension, make sure that you use a graft. This was, we could suture it, neurography could be done directly here. And even in late cases, we have to do this because sometimes the sensory protective sensations will be given. It's a short distance for the nerve to transfer. So it's worth doing even a late repair with a graft. Now, leprosy, if you have a case, they would ask you, what is the timing of surgery? When do you want to do the surgery for these patients? So at least 6 months of good clinical response to medical treatment, that's what should be there. There should be no reaction or neuritis in the last 6 months. There should be no nerve tenderness, no active thing going on there. And the deformity should be of at least 1 year, means it should be stable and irreversible. It's an evolving deformity. You are not going and doing a tendon transfer and trying to correct because it's a progressive thing. So generally, we wait for about 6 months to 1 year. There should be a good response to medical treatment. And then you go and think of doing tendon transfers for these patients. The second question asked, especially in ulnar claw hand, would be, would you just correct the only two fingers of ulnar claw or all the four fingers? Now, all fingers ideally is corrected, even in ulnar nerve palsy, unless it's done purely for cosmetic reasons, which is very rare, because external stability of fingers is affected when intraoccipitally are paralyzed and resulting in a weak grip. And then lumbrical maintain the internal stability. So both are damaged here. At least lumbricals, these two lumbricals are paralyzed. but all the intraocular damage. So for you to have a good grip, you have to operate on all the fingers if you do a tendon transfer. Pre-op therapy is very important, getting rid of contractures like this, which I told you. These are things which are followed in classic leprosy institutes, actually. Splint, cylindrical cast, and overcome established adaptive patterns like wrist flexing habits. So you need to give a splint and start correcting it early. In very, very important thing is isolation and contraction of donor muscle. So if you know you're using the FDS of middle finger here, you should teach the patient to strengthen that. So that if it is slightly weak for whatever reasons, because leprosy is more of a systemic kind of a, this one. So sometimes they could be still weak, even though median nerve might not be involved, they get more power. So in a foot drop, if you have, for example, a patient with common peroneal palsy, you should isolate the tibialis posterior and start strengthening it 1 month before, so that when you do a tendon transfer, it will be almost a good grade 5 power. So same kind of principle should be adapted in all types of these conditions. Now, surgical procedures, they will ask you what are the things you know. The two major things is passive or static procedures, where the existing forces are rearranged or new non-muscular structures are introduced. And they generate force moments that will counter the tendency of cloy. So that is a static procedures. Active or dynamic is basically your tendon transfer. So muscle substitution by tendon transfer, that will give extra force. When do you do these two things? Static procedure will work when, that's why now your assisted angles will come into picture. So static procedures will work when assisted angle is less than 30 degrees. So we just need some amount of, creating an MCP flexion there. And the claw involves one or two fingers only. And the principle is basically you are limiting the MCP extension and preventing the hyperextension. And they don't provide active MCP flexion because it's not a tendon transfer. You're just creating that MCP flexion here by some procedure so that the claw gets abolished. Common procedures asked again is Zancolis volar capsular reflex. This is asked as a short note a lot of times. It's always combined with a flexor pulley advancement. So that is what it is. The other procedure we do is a dermadesis. Skin itself is made into a contracture, and then you add a flexor pulley advancement. There's a procedure by Dr. Srinivasan called extensor diversion grafting. And there's also a procedure where they put a bone block posteriorly to give that flexion of the MCP called posterior bone block procedure by Mike. Now, this is what happens here in capsular reflex. Basically, we are shortening the anterior capsule here. So we take a part of the capsule here, cut it, and then shorten it and suture it. So you're creating a MCP flexion contraction. That's what is it. And then what is pulley advancement is we remove that A1 pulley. So once the A1 pulley is removed here, what happens is the tendon bowstrings. Okay. So the A1 pulley was somewhere here. So that is removed. So you cut through that, then it will start flexing at A2 pulley now. So we're iatrogenically creating a bowstring here, so that MCP flexes here. So these two are combined together. So this is a clinical photograph here, intraop photograph. This is the capsule with a part of the ulna plate. I've made a flap here like this, okay? And sutures are taken through that. And then it is sutured there with the MCP inflection. So this is your classical ulnar capsular reflex. And of course you cut open the pulley here, the A1 pulley. So that becomes your pulley advancement. Now dynamic procedures are intrinsic substitution, which means you are substituting the paralyzed muscle with a tendon transfer. Procedures to provide an independent PIP flexor also is one of the things. And sometimes we do what's called as intrinsic reactivation. Means the same way how the intraosseous and lumbricals are, we put in the grafts, the tendon grafts there to create that loss of intrinsics. So these are the different procedures. So the most important principle here is any tendon you transfer should go to the same course as the paralyzed lumbrical muscle. And how does the lumbrical go? It goes volar to the deep transverse metacarpal ligament along the lumbrical canal, and it will go and reach the lateral band of the extensor expansion. So MCP will flex, IP will extend. That's how the lumbrical work functions from the FDP joint, the lumbrical FDP tendon, the lumbrical arises, and they go like this. So your tendon also should go in the same path like this. We can use donors on the volar side like this, the FDS classic Bunnell's transfer, at least one or two transfers you should know of each of these. FDS transfer, Bunnell's or Brand's transfer. Palmaris longus can be taken, but you need an associated additional graft is required because it can't reach the fingers. or even FCR can be used. On the extensor side or the dorsal side, you can use the ECRL or ECRB, or EIP and EDM can be used. So choice of tendon, if somebody asks you which one will you choose, the FDS is the ideal tendon because it's got a lot of power. So FDS transfer avoids tendon anastomosis with a graft like how we use for palmaris longus. And in high ulnar palsy, if FDP is also weak of the ring finger, then you opt for middle finger FDS. Otherwise, ring finger FDS is taken usually. Now, if there's stiff hands or manual laborers, that they require a strong tendon, that's when the FDS is used. So if you have a patient who has got a lot of manual laborer who's got stiff hand, then tell I would like to use the Bunnell's transfer, which is the FDS transfer. Hypermobile hands, if there is some amount of hypermobility, Asian hands, they require weaker transfers, then we use palmaris longus. Habitual wrist flexing, if somebody is adapted to that wrist flexing, then use the FCR because then you can take one deforming force out. If there's a strong wrist extensor with weak flexor, then we use a ECRL. Radial nerve is intact, so you would use ECRL. But if there's no FDS or wrist flexor or extensor, then we use a EIP or a EDM transfer. So choice of tendons is based on the patient, how we do this. So this is a FDS. We have taken it from the middle finger here, and it comes out of the carpal tunnel here. It has two slips already there. It divides into two. All of you know that. So that is made into four slips. So each one is split into two. It made into four slips here like this. So as I said, it has to go through the lumbrical canal here. So it has to go deep to the transverse carpal ligament, metacarpal ligament, and onto the lateral expansion. That is the principle of any of these tendon transfer. We have something like this to maintain the position here and get the right tension. So we have something devised like this. A lot of centers who do regular tendon transfers have some apparatus like this. Now that is the FDS transfer. The second one is you give a PIP flexor. So if you give a PIP flexor, the MCP will also flex like this. So this is a Zancoli's procedure. So the FDS slips, a lasso is basically used by the cowboys to, tackle these horses or cows. So this is the lasso which is used here. So same thing, we use the tendon graft to go around the A1 pulley and then pull it down like this. Okay, recommended with Asian hands with thin, long, hypermobile PIP joints. It does not add to the extending forces acting on the PIP and hence prevents the span neck deformity. Just an example, this is a palmaris longus. I've used a tensor fasciae latae graft here so that I can get the length here. And that is split into four slips here. And they go into the A1 pulley here. And then they come back and get sutured onto themselves. So this is what we do when we transfer this. And then that arch and your cascade has to come back when you're tensioning these. That's very, very important. If you have a total claw hand, the only thing additional procedure you should know is opponentsplasty. Median nerve is paralyzed here. So you need to do an opponentsplasty here. So this is an extensor indicis transfer we are showing here. So remember that you have an extensor indicis, extensor digitorum, both slips are there, correct? So the extensor digitorum is always on the radial side and the extensor indicis is always on the ulnar side. Okay, so always remember that extra tendons is always on the ulnar side. Same with the little finger here also. So extensor digitorum is on the radial side here and extensor indicis on the ulnar side. It was already harvested, just showing that here. And it comes out here at this point in the fifth compartment here, extensor compartment, you take it out here outside. Again, for opponentsplasty, the only principle is it has to come from the ulnar side towards the thumb. So always there should be a pulley system here so that the opposition is good for the patient. So we come on this is an Anderson tunneler, which is passed from the ulnar side here. And then the tendon is taken from there. Okay. So these instruments sometimes can be kept in the viva. You should know these, right? That's the most important biomechanical point there. And then we suture it here toward to the abductor pollicis brevis insertion and also sometimes to the capsule also, okay? The MP joint capsule also here. So that's how you get the opposition. So that's just a video showing so this is the affected side. So he's got that opposition. So you see the transfer here standing out here, okay? He's able to oppose, he's able to hold objects here. You see that wasting here for a total claw hand. He can use this hand for different objects. So that opposition has come back here with this opponentsplasty. It's a very rewarding procedure, but you need to know when to do these kind of things. So in summary, I would say that determine the level of the lesion and the etiology. Is this high-level injury, low-level injury? Is it post-traumatic? Is it post-Hansen's? Very, very important for your management. You demonstrate all the tests on the normal side and then on the paralyzed side. Always, always, any nerve injury patients do this in your exam. Always show it to the normal side, on the normal side for the patient, and then you demonstrate on the paralyzed side. In this case, claw hand, measure the assisted angle, contracture angle. That is very important for you to determine your treatment, whether it is static procedure or a dynamic procedure based on these things. And then test possible donor muscles. Very important for you to tell the examiner, I've already checked the donor muscle and this is the grade for it. So that gives a lot of goodwill for you during the exams. Know the ideal time for surgical management. If it is a post-trauma case, when will you do? If it's a Hansen's, when will you do? That's very, very important. And look at patient's need and activity level to determine the procedure of a choice. If the patient is doing fine work or is a manual laborer, all the things you need to tell the examiner why you choose a particular tendon transfer or a particular procedure. Thank you so much for your attention.
Thanks, Anil. That was really great. I'm sure there'll be a lot of questions, but before we start the question and answer session, I'd just like to inform everybody that Dr. Anil Bhatt has also authored a book, which is on clinical examination, assessment and examination with a catchy acronym, CASES. And maybe, Anil, you can introduce this book to people so that they really know what it's about. And maybe I'm sure they'll all find it useful because I'm sure there's a wealth of material, clinical material there.
Yeah. Thank you, sir. It's got 60 cases. It's got long cases and short cases, a total of 60 cases. And whatever I told you, it's a basically the same pattern I put it in the thing. How, when you enter an exam hall, how a case is given, how you start a case, how you examine, how you present, what questions are asked. So same pattern is put in that. If it's a long case, how you start off with the history, how you do the examination. As I said, what's your clinical diagnosis? What will you do? What are you supposed to answer? And then the principles of management. So this talk is also based in the same way. In the book, it starts always with the clinical scenario, the case, and then it goes, and then it also tells you points in favor for that particular case. So in that way, it's more than a year. Last February, we launched that, and a lot of good feedback in terms of the usefulness of it. So a lot of PGs have used it, and I hope it really serves. We're coming out of the second edition. I've added 15 more cases. So the new edition might have 75 cases. It's covered all from hip to everything, from hip to ankle. All cases are there in this. Thank you, sir.
Do you have the book there with you? Maybe you can show.
Yeah,
great. Wow, that's a thick one.
Yeah, that's a big one.
Yeah.
The last chapter is also a goniometer metric examination, which is very important. Sometimes in the exam, we ask, how do you measure the angle and then fumbling with the goniometer. So the last chapter is actually for each joint, how do you measure using a goniometer, which is sometimes not taught in the routine rounds and everything.
Sure. Excellent. Great. So questions, I'm sure there should be many.
From postgraduate, you can ask directly. Yes, Avinash. Also, about what you have mentioned about that one, I just want to ask you about the hand function, what an postgraduate should know about that. What all hand function? Like, there are many hand function which is mentioned, like even for a pinch, it is different type of pinch. So at a postgraduate level, what is expected, sir, during the examination?
If you break it down into three simple things, it's only, a grip or a grasp, it's a pinch and a hook. These are only three major functions if you really look into that. So a hook is basically when you lift a bag or things like that, right? And a grasping is basically larger objects, okay? And pinch is for the finer. Of course, in pinch you have, this pinch, right? You have all these three fingers use the key pinch, or you have a pulp to pulp pinch, or you have a side pinch. So that's different, but then nobody would really ask you each of these. But if you just ask three major things, it could be only this: grasping activity or a prehensile activity of the hand, a pinch activity and a hook activity. If they know this much, I think they can cover majority of the functions what we routinely do in our, you know, activities of daily living. Yeah.
And so you have mentioned so many tests for claw hand. So is it there any specific test if there is an isolated median nerve which is affected?
I mean, generally, patient won't present with a claw hand if there is a median nerve injury. That's the first thing, because you have only these two lumbricals which are paralyzed. The rest of the lumbricals are intact. The introsha is intact. Everything is intact. So in that way, it compensates. So there's no claw hand as such in isolated median nerve. In isolated ulnar nerve, you have a ulnar claw, okay? And you have a total claw when both are involved. But isolated median nerve, what you get is the classical eighth thumb deformity, right? So that is the only thing which you see clinically. And the only answer they should tell is, if at all, it's very disabling, because thumb can compensate in many ways, actually. So even though it is a median nerve palsy and the thumb is paralyzed there, right? But still, they can do the opposition with so many trick movements and activities. So the opponensplasty procedure is done only if patient really demands it and is very disabled. Otherwise, you don't really go and do much with the isolated median nerve palsy. But if somebody asks you, what is the procedure you do for a median nerve palsy? It is opponensplasty. You have to do the opponens. That's why I showed the video of opponensplasty. They won't come with a claw hand, definitely.
And so,
median nerve problems are more related to carpal tunnel syndromes and traumatic injury where you need to do a repair, etc.
Yeah, but in a median nerve damage, the most important thing is the sensation.
Ulnar nerve,
this sensation is okay, loss is okay compared to the median nerve. This disability is more because most of our activities happen in this radial corner, your thumb, index, and middle finger. So sensory loss is a major disability for median nerve. So even in a traumatic median nerve palsy, even if a patient comes after 2-3 years or even 4 years or up to 5 years, they say that you still do a repair because patient can have some protective sensation back. They might not get motor power, but they will get back some protective sensation. That's very important. As sir was telling, if it's a carpal tunnel, late carpal tunnel, patients come with, you know, this ulcers here, burns and things like that. That is very disabling. Okay, compared to ulnar nerve sensation area. Here, ulnar nerve palsy is basically the hand itself, the motor power is the problem. And in median nerve, the major problem is the sensation. So that's the difference.
So how do you see the ulnar nerve abscess today? Because I remember operating on some of them 15, 20 years ago, but I haven't done one for ages now. So do you still?
We had one recently, sir. After a long time, we had one.
As you said,
because the medical management is so good nowadays.
Good.
So those kind of things we don't see often. And unless patient has defaulted on the treatment and they've gone into problems, otherwise you don't really see them. We were thinking the same thing and recently we got one.
Interesting. So what about I think we need questions from the postgraduates.
Sir, good evening. How do we differentiate, sir, clinically between higher ulnar palsy and lower ulnar palsy?
Okay.
Clinically, in the after any external sign?
I showed you the ulnar paradox, correct?
Yes.
So that is your first sign. So if the claw is minimal, it means that probably it's a high ulnar nerve palsy. You have to look for that. So which means high, see, normally we assume that higher the lesion, there should be more deformity. But in ulnar nerve, it's the reverse. Lower the lesion, the deformity is much more. Because in higher lesion, the ones causing the flexion of the IP joint is also paralyzed, which is the FTP. So ulnar paradox is your first sign, okay? Second, you look for causes. In the sense, you look for cubital tunnel. There could be a problem there. You could look for the neck, anything in the brachial plexus or in the cervical spines, C81 kind of lesion. So that is the next in your examination. If you want to differentiate between them by your examination, the first muscle you check is FCU always. If FCU is not working, okay, if you flex the wrist and ulnar deviate and your FU tendon is not standing out there, means that the FCU is involved. These two FDP will be involved, means it's a high ulnar nerve injury. If FCU is working, then you come down and then you do your CART test and your book test and other things. Okay, so that is a scheme of your examination. So start with FCU. FCU is working. You know it's a low ulnar nerve injury. So low ulnar nerve injury, what will you do? You'll come, you'll do the CAR test, you'll book, do the book test. You might do the other signs which I showed you. You'll check the sensation in the autonomous zone, which is the little finger. And then you tell, sir, FCU is working, FDP is working. So this is a low ulnar nerve injury because of the loss of the intraosseous function, because of loss of adductor function and sensory deficit. This is how the answer should be.
Yes.
Yes, Sachin, you have one.
Yes, sir. Sir, one question from my side is, in CAT test, format sign, does we also look for the same as the CAT test movements, which means the book also sleeps or the look for some other movements of the finger?
If I got you right, means does the card come out or you know, something like that? How strongly the patient holds the card? Is that your question?
No, sir. In CAT test, the card slips out. In format sign also look the same, sir. Format sign is the same test or is different?
No. In Froment's, you're using a book, first thing, not a card. So it's something to hold on strongly. So you're using these two. You're using the adductor and the first dorsal intraosseous like this. So you need to hold the book like this. So if I can show you. So you need to hold the book like this, parallel. Okay. Yes. So you're holding it strong like this. So both are working and holding it. Now, if there's a paralysis of ulnar nerve, means the first dorsal intraosseous is paralyzed, the adductor pollicis is paralyzed. So both are not there. So the patient tries to hold it by flexing the IP joint of the thumb, which is the FPL. And FPL is supplied by the median nerve, correct? So patient holds. So you are supposed to look at that flexion of the thumb here in a book test. That is your Froment sign. Okay, so you hold that, patient is trying to grab somehow and he uses his FPL, which is supplied by the median nerve. The book will only slip if both median nerve and ulnar nerve are involved. Then FPL is also not working. Then obviously he can't hold either way, right? Then the book will come out. Otherwise, the book is still held by the FPL, which is supplied by the median nerve. Okay?
Yes, sir.
You got it?
Yes, sir.
Yeah.
So the Froment sign is when you're trying to pull the book from him, he flexes his IP joint of the thumb. Yes, but the Froment sign is the fact that he flexes the IP joint of the thumb to hold the book using his FPL instead of what he would use normally, which is the adductor pollicis.
And, and the first dorsal intraosseous.
And the first dorsal intraosseous.
Yeah.
Okay, so I just want to ask, because there are so many test and science in the book. So what is important not to remember during the examination? Because otherwise, so many things supposed to reject used to mug up and the main thing they used to forget. So what is important for them?
Correct. So you're basically trying to show the examiner the function of the intraosseous, right? And telling that there is a weakness of this. You're showing the function of the adductor pollicis. Right now, if you have your Petrus test tube or Egawa's sign, what they call, you know, all these things are everything is telling there is an intraosseous paralysis. Okay. And the best way to show that is the CAR test. Okay. Unless the examiner wants all these tests to be told, you demonstrate these properly, at least two tests. Okay. Sir, I'm showing you the weakness of intraosseous by this test. That's enough. As long as you do it properly, it's good enough. Adductor pollicis, everybody should know, the PGs should know that the only thenar muscle supplied by the ulnar nerve is adductor pollicis. The rest is supplied by the median nerve. There is a flexor pollicis brevis. Sometimes it's also supplied by a dual nerve supply. But otherwise, the adductor pollicis is supplied by the ulnar nerve. The rest all supplied by the median nerve. So that adductor pollicis function have to show by your book test. And the intraosseous are shown by the CAR test. Even undergraduates, we teach the same thing. Postgraduates, maybe additional one or two signs like, you know, the Egawa sign or a Wartenberg sign. They should just know these things. They need not demonstrate all these things. No examiner would go on asking all the tests, please tell me all the, you know, 10 signs. Because if you see so many textbooks, there are so many signs described. Okay. So make sure you show how to examine the FCU, FDP, and then these two additional tests, and don't forget the sensation. So if you do this much, I think everybody will be convinced.
And sir, about the sensation, how the postgraduate should examine in the exam? What sensation?
Yeah. sensory examination is a very subjective thing in the sense that it depends on how you test and how the patient responds. So it should be done very objectively from the PG and from the candidate side. So first step is ask the patient to close the eyes. Second, you give simultaneous stimulus to both the sides. You can use your fingertips, you can use a cotton wasp or something, but then basically you give simultaneous stimulus to both. So I'm checking the little finger sensation, right? So I need to give simultaneous stimulus both the sides, give continuous stimulus so that patient understands what you're doing. So patient is closing the eyes. We need to ask two questions. First question is, are you able to feel? Okay. He should say yes or no, right? Are you able to feel on both the sides? You should say yes or no. If yes, then you ask, is there a difference? Don't ask the patient, are you feeling less here, more here, or whatever. Don't give leading questions, okay? You just say, are you feeling on both the sides, right? If patient says yes, you ask, is there a difference? Patient says yes. Then you ask a third question, what is the difference you're finding? Okay, is it, you know, patient should tell that. Is he feeling it less compared to the opposite side, or if he's feeling more? So there are four types. One is anesthesia, means he's not feeling anything. One is hyperesthesia. One is hyperesthesia. One is paresthesia, means there is an altered sensation. So these are the four responses you should expect. Okay. No, I'm not absolutely feeling anything on this side means anesthesia, right? If he's feeling and there's a difference, you should ask what is the difference. Then patient tell, I feel less on this side compared to that side. Or he tells, I feel totally different compared to that side. Or some people very rarely tell, I feel more, you know, it's like a burning kind of a thing. So hypo, hyper, paresthesia. So this is the way you need to do. Okay. Very objectively, we have to test so that we get the best answer from the patient.
And so in the exam, sir, the examiner used to ask to test all the three nerves by a single test. And few of the candidates, or even during our teaching, it was one is okay sign, another one is to make a fist. So just elaborate about that thing, sir. What?
Yeah, it's not just make a fist and thumbs up sign. That's what we were taught, like, okay. So making a fist is basically for median and ulnar nerve, and the thumbs up is for the radial nerve. So this is the one like this, okay. And this again, okay sign is again the same thing, right? You're extending your fingers here. So your radial nerve function here and your median nerve and ulnar nerve is coming opposition and this flexion of the FTP of this, all these things. So it's not like something which is, you know, very specific or a correct test, but it's just a quick test, that's all. But I find this thumbs up sign is a good thing because you're flexing everything nicely here, okay? And then you're also making sure your thumb is extended nicely, so that shows the radial nerve function also. So we were taught the thumbs up sign.
Okay. Okay, great. Any more questions from the postgraduates? Otherwise,
yeah,
we'll call it a day for today.
Any other muscle which assesses the function of the lumbricals?
Any other muscle?
Which assesses the function of lumbricals, sir?
Lumbricals.
The lumbricals. Lumbricals is basically an independent flexor of the MCP joint. Now, if you look, you should know the principle that any tendon which crosses a joint also acts on the proximal joints, which means your FDP and FDS can also act on the MCP joints. They can also flex actually. But if you look at the classic MCP, so the MCP function is told as pen holding position, which means basically MCP flexion and IP extension, right? So independent MCP flexor is only lumbrical. But because FDS and FDP are going all the way till, you know, distally also, they can also act on the proximal joint. So they're also there to assess the lumbrical function. Okay.
Thank you, sir.
Okay, so great. Thank you very much, Anil. That was excellent. And I'm sure all the postgraduates have learned a great deal from this session today. I think you can go over the talk again, because it's probably recorded and available for you people. So I think it would be useful to actually go over it again a couple of times to remember all the details. I think there's so much information there that you really should make use of it to the maximum. Okay, thank you very much, Anil, and great.
Thank you, sir.
And hopefully see you again for something.
Sure, sir. Anytime for you. Anytime to you. Thank you so much for the opportunity. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much.
Thanks a lot. Okay. Okay. Bye, everybody. Thanks. Okay.
Thank you, sir.
Bye. Thanks, Neeraj and Shamsul.
Thank you so much, sir. We will try.
Yeah. We will try. Or even peripheral nerve scheme of examination, you can, like for postgraduate, he asked how to do high versus low and everything. So
okay.
Have a talk on all the three nerves, how to do it quickly in the exam, like, you know,
yeah, like,
how
to. And brachial plexus.
Yeah, brachial plexus is another thing which can be told. Yeah. Let me know. No problem. Anytime.
Thank you so much, sir. It was great.
Thank you. Thanks. Bye.